That temptation won't affect us at all, at all, at all. But just like anyone else, if I let it hit my heart, I'll fall, I'll fall, I'll fall.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, the Bible says if I have breath in my lungs, I better praise him, amen. Hallelujah. So we have an awesome opportunity today to thank him for the life that he has given us, for everything that he has done for us. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Oh, yeah. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name.
Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Our
Somebody's saying, preach, preacher. Oh, Lord, I'm just getting comfortable. All right, we're going to the book of Psalms, chapter 23. Psalms 23. And we'll just start reading at verse number 1. We're going to read through the end of the chapter. It's a real long chapter. If I can get this iPad to open up. There we go. All right, Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. So that tells me he's a good shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. It's not daddy's. It's not mama's. It's not yours. It's mine. The Lord is my shepherd. You better have a my shepherd. If you have a my shepherd, then you don't have to want. During this pandemic time, it's good to have a my shepherd. All right, verse number 2. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. Green pastures, still waters, that's good things. That's blessings. Number 3. He restoreth my soul. Oh, yeah. Restore my soul. Leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. You can follow him and find righteousness. All right, the next verse, 4. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, even though I go through dark places, even though I have to walk a dark mile, even though I go through death, I will fear no evil. Why? Thou art with me. My shepherd is with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. I'm going to find comfort. Verse 5. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Wow. Even though I'm in dark places, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'm going to find a table. I'm going to find oil. And I'm going to find a cup. Verse 6. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Last Sunday, if you remember, and that's always a blessing to a preacher, if people can just remember what you preach. I asked somebody, do you remember what I preached last Sunday? And they said, I said, well, I was hoping you could help me remember. But I preached last Sunday about faith in the dark. I couldn't get away from it all week long. And so today I'm going to preach about blessings in the dark. When we think about what it means to be blessed, most of the time we think about good things that happen to us, maybe a promotion on the job. Maybe a child was born. Maybe in our sickness, we had a return to good health. See, blessings in good times go hand in hand. And we like that. We love it. Oh, bless me, Lord. Because when we think of those blessings, we think about those good times. It's easy to celebrate when everything's going right. But what about those dark times? What about those difficult times? Maybe there was a downsizing on the job, or you got furloughed, or maybe, just be blunt and say, you got laid off, you lost it. Maybe someone walked out of the relationship. Maybe it was sickness. And it seems like health is a long ways off. Good health is a long ways off. Where are the blessings in those dark times? Where are the blessings when we find ourselves fellowshipping a mystery? Where are those dark times when it seems like there is no help? Christmas time 2009, our family thought we would be celebrating a great Christmas holiday, enjoying each other and having fun and fellowship. Instead, we learned that I had been diagnosed with colon cancer. It was a somber Christmas. It was a hard Christmas, facing surgery, facing the unknown. Is it possible that we can gain blessings while we live in the dark that we could never gain if there was no dark? It doesn't matter how much is in your bank account. Doesn't matter what kind of house you live in, cars you drive, jobs you have, clothes you wear. Every one of us. You may be blessed with friends without end. But every one of us, you live long enough, will go through a time of darkness. Maybe it's sickness, some type of loss. Maybe it's a child who crushes our heart. It's so easy then to get discouraged. It's so easy then to want to give up and walk away. It's so easy then to want to quit. It's so easy then to think, well, this is it. It's over. But I want you to know today, God uses the dark times. God is not just for the good times. It's a part of His plan. You see, there's seeds of greatness in each one of us. There's those seeds of potential. There's those seeds of breakthrough, of service that's in each one of us. But notice I said seeds. Seeds only come to life in the dark. As long as it stays in the light, seed will never reach what it was created to be. It must be put in that lonely place, in that dark place, so that the potential that's on the inside of the seed can break through and come to life. And that's why those seeds that are in darkness in each one of us, if we will apply them, if we will use them, we will find greatness. I look in the Bible and I find those mighty heroes of faith. Look at Moses. Made a mistake. Messed up. Killed an Egyptian. Buried him in the sand. Forgot about him. Had to flee. And for 4 decades, there he was on the backside of the desert, feeling like it was over with. I've blown it. But something happened to Moses. On the backside of a desert, in loneliness, in feeling abandoned, in feeling abused and misused, something was happening to him. He was being shaped. He was finding development and preparation. God was using that dark place to mold patience and humility, strength, and trust. Without the dark place on the backside of nowhere, Moses never would have been able to raise up the rod at the command of God and watch the Red Sea roll back and lead Israel into a promised land. Come on, somebody. The dark place was a requirement for Moses to go through in order that he could step into the fullness of his destiny. I'm preaching to people here today. You know what it is to fellowship a mystery. You know what it is to look in a glass darkly. You know what it is to not understand what's going on. But you hear this preacher today. There is help. There is hope. Because God is not just a God of the light. He's also a God in the darkness. Just so you are thinking that it's just for men. No, it wasn't just Moses. I look at the woman named Esther. She was an orphan. She lost both her parents when she was quite young. She's now living in a foreign country. She feels alone. She feels forsaken. She feels abandoned. She's living in a dark place. The command has been given that all her people would be slain. But hold on a minute. Hey, in that dark place, God raised up Esther to save her people. But I'm just a girl. I'm just a young woman. What can I do? I'm living in a dark place. But God said, in the darkness, I'm getting ready to promote you. In your darkness, I'm getting ready to raise you up. Come on, I'm preaching to somebody here today. You feel alone. You feel abandoned. You feel like there's no way out. I'm here to tell you there's hope. There's joy. There's victory. You're saying, but I can't make it. None of us can make it by ourselves. But in your dark place, if you'll look to God, He will show up. Preaching about the dark places, you cannot overlook Joseph. Betrayed by his brothers. Falsely accused. Put in prison. Living in that dark place. But he had a dream. He had hope. God had given him a sure word, a prophecy about his life, and he wouldn't give it up. Even though he's betrayed, even though he's been abandoned, even though he's been lied on, even though he finds himself in prison, he says, I'm not quitting. I'm not giving up. I've got a dream. I have potential. I have a promise. I'm trusting God. And it was in the prison. It was in the dark place. It was in the loneliness. But he turned to God, and God raised him up. He became second to Pharaoh. He ruled the most powerful nation on the face of the earth in his lifetime. Wow. I'm preaching to people here today. Come on, make up in your mind. I'm not quitting. I'm not giving up. I'm not abandoning. Oh, well, my marriage and my relationship and my parenting and my job, my health, my wealth. Come on. God wouldn't let me get away from this. I didn't mean to turn this into a series and preach more than one time on it. And people after the first service said, oh, my preacher, you might as well make that into a series. I don't know. Maybe next Sunday it'll be something else about being blessed in the dark. But we had faith in the dark last week. This week we find the blessings in the dark. Come on, that was Elijah. He just had a great breakthrough on the mountain. The prophets of Baal were slain. God answered by fire. But when he come down off the mountain, darkness enveloped him. The queen said, I want his head. And he felt so alone. He felt so abandoned. He felt like there was just the Bible says he wanted to die. He just had the great breakthrough, but now it's in the valley low, and he's just wanting to die. And he says, I'm all alone. And God spoke to him in the dark place and said, get up. I got 7,000 more just like you. Come on, get up. It's time to go. It's time to run. It's time to win. I'm preaching to somebody. You feel abandoned. You feel alone. Hey, why don't you just lay aside the weight and sin which does so easily beset you and rise up and say, greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. The weapons of my warfare are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations. Hey, I'm gonna make it. Somebody shout, I'm making it. Come on, you're a winner, not a loser. It's time to go up, not down. It's time to go over, not under. We're alive, we're ahead. We can't leave out one of the greatest heroes of faith, and that's David. Remember him? He's the one that slew Goliath, took the giant's head off. He's the one that restored the nation. Israel crowned him king. Judah crowned him king. Wow, look at him. Look at all the might that he had. Jerusalem is his capital. Look at what he's done. Oh, but that David had an affair with a married woman. Put her husband on the front line in battle where he would be killed. The baby that was born to that union now lies for 7 days between death and life and finally dies. And David is pushed down into a dark place that he didn't want, but it's by his own hand. And he wanted out of it. And maybe that's when he wrote about, oh, for the wings of a dove, for I would fly away and be at rest. And he's just hoping and just wishing and just. But David got up and shook himself and went back to God. And the writer of the book of Acts, so many years later, recorded this about David. He was a man that was after God's own heart. Oh, yeah. You may not realize it, but in the dark place, that's where you grow. That's where you multiply. That's where characters develop. That's where you learn to trust God. That's where you learn how to persevere. That's where your spiritual muscles are made strong. In the dark places, that's where we pray more. That's where we get closer to God. It's in the dark places. That's where we take time to be quiet and listen. And God speaks into our lives. I'm preaching to somebody now. It's in the dark places that your priorities are realized. Where you take time to slow down and get quiet. And listen to what's right and what's real. And you start appreciating what you have. You get your eyes off of what you've lost. Oh, yeah. Come on. When I lost my twin brother in June, and then I was found with colon cancer in December, and then in May, my mother passed away on Mother's Day, and my best friend in ministry died in November. Then my father-in-law died in May. Within 23 months, it just seemed like it was nothing but darkness. It was just a long tunnel, but there was no light at the end of it. And it just stretched on and on and on. Well, what else can happen? And who else is going to take their departure? And what are we doing? And where are we going? But friend, it was in that 23 months of darkness. It was in that time when it seemed like it was all crashing down that that I found inner bracing. It was here that I found I was blessed. In that dark time, I learned lessons that have helped me today. I'm preaching to somebody now. You're going to find new growth. You're going to find more confidence. You're going to find endurance. You'll find resolve. You're saying, oh, I curse the darkness. Oh, but listen to me. In Exodus chapter 20, it says, Moses drew near the thick darkness where God was. He's not just a God of the light. He's a God of the dark. He's not just a God of the mountain. He's a God of the valley. Come on. I'm preaching to somebody today in that dark place. Hold on. Hold on. You see, it's during those times that you're not going to complain about those inconsistencies. You're not going to get mad because somebody took your parking spot. It's during that time, you don't get angry because somebody cut you off. You don't lose your joy because you're stuck in traffic. You don't get offended because somebody's rude to you. You've been through too much to just give in to the sour things of life. Somewhere in that darkness, your backbone is turning to steel. Somewhere in that hardship, somewhere in going through that, you're saying, I'm going to get up and I'm going to march on. I may be in darkness. I may not be able to see my hand in front of my face, but I'm trusting. I'm having confidence. The God who brought me here is the God who's going to bring me out. Somebody told me, said, well, don't you know they're saying this about you and saying that about you and complaining about you and got bad things to say? I said, look, man, I've learned a long time ago, I don't worry about that. Because if God can bring me through my brother passing, if God can bring me through when I had colon cancer, if God can bring me through that valley where my mama died on Mother's Day, if God can bring me through my best friend dying at Thanksgiving, if God can bring me through my father-in-law taking his leave, well, then what's that that they're talking about me? I know greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. Hey, I love the good times. I like the sunshine. But I've learned also that I can dance in the dark. I've also learned I can persevere in the dark. I'm not looking for dark times, but when they come, I know who my Redeemer is. I know in whom I have trusted. Woo. Hallelujah. You see, it wasn't the good times that brought the best out in me. It was those bad times that God showed up. You see, you may feel like you're so lonely that there's no help, there's no hope, that you can't make it on your own. But it's right there where you're going to learn. God's going to see me through. God's going to bring me through. Oh, that's when I really learned how to pray. That's when I really learned how to develop that unshakable confidence in who He is. That's where I found my faith was stretched. Hey, don't complain about the dark places. It is there that you find those blessings. God is working. God, in your affliction, He's saying, I'm here with you. I'm going to walk with you. I am grateful for a God. I can call Him my shepherd, and He will lead me and He will guide me. And it may be the valley of the shadow of death. It can be darkness, But there I find a table, and I find oil, and I find a cup. The table is blessings. That oil is anointing in the presence of God, and the cup is the joy of living. I'm preaching to somebody today. I wish I had time to go into all of that, but you got to make up in your mind. I'm not serving God just for good times, but even in the dark, even in the night, even there, I find Him. And I walk with Him. Wow. I love reading the Bible. Psalms 105, verse 18. I find that God blessed Joseph. He was put in prison for 13 years, falsely accused. And the Bible simply says in the Amplified Version, he was laid in chains of iron, and his soul entered into that iron. The King James says, whose feet they hurt with fetters, and he was laid in iron. When you go back and read it in the original, he put his confidence, he put his trust, he put his beliefs in the iron that bound him. And that seems to be far-fetched. It seems to be, you don't do that. Because what do? We resist. We shake and we rattle those chains. One translation said it was an iron collar around his neck. And so we want to pull on that collar, and we want to try to get it up off of us. But not with Joseph. Joseph, when he was betrayed. Joseph, when he was lied on. Joseph, when he was forgotten and abandoned, languishing in the prison. We don't ever read to where he tried to get out, where he complained bitterly, where he just felt like it's over with, forget the dream. No, he kept his mind on the dream. He kept his trust in his God. And even though it kept getting worse, and it kept getting worse, and it kept getting worse, and the years were turning into decades. What are you doing, Joseph? He said, I'm not giving up my hope. He said, I'm going to put my soul into the iron that binds me. In other words, God, I may be bound up right now, but you know the way I go. You know the path I've taken. You have led me here. If all this happened to me, it had to come by you first. And you have to put confidence that I'm going to make it. You gave me that dream. You gave me that vision. And I'm not stopping. I haven't seen it come to pass yet. And so I'm not giving up. I'm putting my soul into my iron. And that's when he said, this is going to deliver me. It's holding me now, but it's going to be my deliverance. And when the time was right, and the king had a dream, and the king's wise men could not interpret, it was the iron that held Joseph in prison that delivered him to the king. If he would have been in his father's house with the coat of many colors, with the position of blessing, he never would have been there when the king needed him. If he would have been in Potiphar's household, he never would have been in position. If he had not have been forgotten, he would have never been in position. It was what he put his trust in, his soul into. And it, come on, in the midst of your dark time, are you just running around getting bitter, getting mean, allowing it to fester in you, allowing it to get you upset and angry, and it's just all this that's against me? And nobody would fault you, because everybody's saying, oh man, if I had to go through that, I'd be just like you. Yeah, I can't believe you're, No, you just say, God, you brought me here. God, you put me here. There must be a reason. I'm putting my soul into this iron. I'm going to make it. So quit complaining what you're going through. Quit saying how unfair it is. Quit talking about who's done you wrong. make up in your mind, I may be uncomfortable, I may not like it, but all things work together for the good. And I'm believing it. I'm called according to your purpose. And if your purpose means a chain and darkness and a prison, that's where I'm going. But I know you're going to bring me out. You're going to deliver me. You're going to put me in a very better place. Come on. In your darkness, you're getting stronger. You're developing something that's going to help you. When you do get the light, you can't reach your highest potential being in the light all the time. Show me a child that's born with a silver spoon in their mouth. Show me a child that's given anything and everything they want. Show me a child that has nothing but blessings. Show me a child that never learns how to appreciate the dark times. And I'll show you a child that's spoiled rotten. I'll show you a child that doesn't know how to relate to people and doesn't know how. And so everything is turning wrong. I'm telling you, you better go through some dark times in your life. You better know. Then you'll know how to appreciate the good. I'm preaching to somebody right now. If you have no opposition, if you have no problems, if you have no one coming against you, oh, that may sound good, but it will stunt your growth. It will stop you. Come on. Appreciate that dark time. I'm not saying that I'm glorying in my hardships. No, but I'm learning from them. I'm going to school. I'm going to find the blessing. But if I'm complaining and griping and I'm bitter and I'm angry and I'm upset and I'm frustrated, I'll miss the blessing. Psalms chapter 4 and verse 1, the King James Version simply says, remember David was writing it, David said, God enlarged me in the time of my distress. Wow. He didn't grow in the good times. He was enlarged, he said. I was enlarged during the bad times. See, as a teenager, David wanted to be that one running around with his friends. You know, he didn't want to be on the backside of the desert keeping watch over the sheep. He's a teenager. I want to be home. I want to, yeah, Dad, give me the car. Turn the music up, boys. Let's have a party. Give me the beat now. Let's do it. Let's go. No, Dad wants me on the backside of nowhere. Dad wants me in the loneliness. Dad wants me where it's just me and a motley bunch of sheep. What is this? But you hear me. It was in his loneliness. It was when he was by himself on the backside of the pasture. He's way out there, no one to help him. That's where he was prepared to be a champion. Because that's where the bear came and that's where the lion came. And he said, the hand of God came upon me and I slew them. And so now when he's out there checking on his brothers, just bringing them some drink and some food. And he hears the giant in the valley. And he looks around and nobody's going. He says, this guy's defying the armies of God. What's the deal? And he rose up. And you can read it right there. 1 Samuel 13, he says, or 17, is not there a cause? The rest of them were afraid. The rest of them, they're trying to interrupt me. It's going to take more than that to stop me. Come on now. Oh, yeah, they're trying to hold him back. Oh, yeah, but he said, no. The bear came. The lion came. Everybody else, the generals all the way down, they're all scared to death. The king is hiding in his tent. Everybody's in their foxhole. No, we can't go fight him. But a little boy that knows what it is to make the darkness pay. He squeezed out of his darkness everything he could so he could find the blessing in it. And the blessing in his dark times caused him to rise up and say, you can come against me with sword and spear, but I will remember the name of the Lord my God. Hey, I'm preaching to somebody right now. You're in darkness, but what are you learning? You're in darkness, but are you growing? You're in darkness, but what are you becoming? Psalms 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. And though thou walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. You can trust God. Oh yeah, you can trust God. He doesn't leave you in the dark, but he gets closer to you in the dark. You feel alone, you feel abandoned, you feel mistreated, you think that it hasn't been fair, but you can trust the one who led you there. You can trust him. Hallelujah. Psalms 23, we've already read to you today. What happened? Yeah, right there. In the valley of the shadow of death, what do I find? That table prepared. The oil to pour and what it would mean. And then a cup that overflows. Wow. Oh, here we are. What are you doing with your darkness? What are you doing with your despair? What are you learning? What are you gaining? The enemy says, just curse God and die. But old Job said, though you slay me, yet I'm going to live for you. Come on, you got to learn. Though you slay me, yet will I, in order to live with him, you got to let him slay you. Hey, come on, I'm preaching to a mama. I'm preaching to a daddy. I'm preaching to grandparents. I'm preaching to children and youth and young adults. You got to rise up and say, I can. I can. My hope, my trust, it's in Jesus Christ. Come on. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Here in our church, John and Dana Marlin went through that dark night. They still struggle in it. The loss of their oldest son, the accident which took his life. Where are we? What are we doing? What are we learning? Where are we going? How can this make us better? Life has a way of telling you it'll never be there. After the first service today, Brother Dennis was telling me about his wife, Kim. And he was saying, oh, preacher, I remember the dark times after that accident. She could just sit there in that chair, couldn't raise her arms or legs, and just sit there. And it was hard for her to read, but she would listen to the Word of God. And in the midst of her darkness, she said, I'm trusting and I'm learning. And then it was learning to walk again and have that one leg on that little trolley moving around. And how many months and a year or more. And there she was. But she's back in church. An elder of our church. Heading up our singles ministry. She's not quitting. She said, in the darkness, I'm going to make it. In the darkness, I'm going to live. I'm preaching to somebody. Where are you? What are you going through? What are you looking for? Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Sister Jan, she sent me a text 2 or 3 weeks ago, I believe it was, a friend in an accident and his spinal cord severed and just paralyzed and what all. And she sent me a text this week and they said a miracle has happened. God has showed up. Hey, in her darkness with that family, she's met me in that foyer and it's where she first told me. She said, Pastor, let's pray right now. Let's believe God. We're still praying. I'm looking for a complete restoration. Hey, what are you talking about? In your dark time,
don't quit. You find the blessing. You find the hope. You find the joy. Hallelujah. Jesus endured the cross. Paul wrote about in Hebrews. He put up with the cross. He went through the cross for the joy that was set before him. To find the joy, he had to endure the cross. I'm preaching to somebody. You're in darkness. You're in darkness. It's misunderstanding. There's no hope. Maybe the health is gone. Maybe you've lost your wealth. Maybe it just seems like friends have been abandoned. Don't give up. Look for the blessing. Our heads are bowed and eyes are closed. God's talking to hearts right now. Oh yeah, it's not time to give up. It's not time to turn back. It's not time to quit. The sun may have set, but joy's coming in the morning. The darkness cannot endure forever, because joy is coming in the morning. Victory is coming. Help is coming. So hold on. Lord Jesus, I pray for each one of these that are gathered here in this service today. God, I pray for this. I pray for all of us. That Lord, as our hands shake and our eyes dim, and age creeps up upon us, or maybe it was sickness or an accident that has caused our health to wither under that bright sun. Help us today, O Lord, to look to you, to put our hope and our confidence in you, and to trust you. God, I pray right now, would you raise your hands to heaven? They're going to sing about Jesus right now. Raise your hands. Would we stand here in the building? Oh, it seems like, well, I just can't make it. There's no way I can get there. But there's help. I sing Jesus.
In the dark, in the depths.
In the dark, in the depths.
You're my rest.
He's my hope.
On this rock I stand. I will sing Jesus. Just be still, oh my soul. I will wait on the Lord. He has overcome.
Oh yeah.
I will sing Jesus.
Raise your hands. Raise your hands to Jesus. Submit to the Lord. There's help. He's our help. He's our rest. I love you, Jesus. I need you. I've seen a great life.
Jesus.
Oh yeah.
I will sing Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Raise your hands to heaven right now. Raise your hands to heaven in this building right now. Give yourself to him right now. Oh, don't miss the lesson to be learned in the dark. Don't miss the lesson to be learned in the dark. Trust him. Walk with him. Come on, David. You're learning to be a giant killer on the backside of a desert. Come on, Joseph. You're learning how to rule a nation in that prison house.
Jesus,
that's it. Praise him right now.
I will sing.
Praise him right now. Oh, I give you praise. I give you praise. I give you praise. I thank
just
you,
be still, oh my soul.
Oh my soul.
I will wait on the Lord. He I'm
singing Jesus.
In the dark, in the depths, you're my hope, you're my rest. On this rock I stand, I will sing Jesus. Now just be still, oh my soul, I will wait on the Lord.
I pray for each one here today. Help us to come to you boldly, to enter your presence at that throne of grace, and to make our petition known. Lord, you have said that you will not forsake us, you will not leave us. Thank you that even in the dark times, we can be blessed. Lord, I pray your blessings upon this people. Lord, as we leave your house, help us to house you within our lives, this flesh body. And to allow Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, the fruit of the Spirit, to be ministered through us to all those around us this week. Lord, I pray your blessings upon this people. In Jesus' name.
I lift my hands in total.